It's always exciting. There's no one recipe for doing this. I can't stand up here as the director of the program and give them, if you just do these 10 things, everything will be perfect. Instead, they really have to learn a lot for themselves and figure out what works in the particular communities that they're serving. So I think this will be a really, really interesting experience for all of you. You're welcome to share. Our hashtag is SocialJ on Twitter. And I'm Carrie Brown. I'm the director of the program. And this is our third year. Amazing for me to think about that, because it seems like we just started. So anyway, we will get going then. All right. Sebastian, you ready?
Thank you.
I am Sebastián Aujanet, and this year I focused on people suffering energy insecurity. And I wanted to start with that question, what's energy insecurity anyway? And I want to answer that question talking to you about Kevin, who is someone that I met in the middle of a sweltering morning, in the middle of a heat wave that hit New York City back in August. And I was trying to find people who didn't have access to AC unit in order to cope with the sweltering temperatures. And I met Kevin, and Kevin invited me to his place. And of course, as you can see in that picture, he did have an AC unit, but it was a faulty AC unit. It was the air that was throwing. It was a faulty, it was a terrible smelling air that was going straight to his 2-year-old. And Kevin explained to me that as a NYCHA low income resident, he lived in one of those buildings in the area, it's barely impossible to get an AC unit in a legal way, because you need to pay for a special appliances fee, and you also need to, you know, pay for some other installation costs and stuff. This was the best that he can do. So Kevin is just one of the examples of energy insecurity, which in a way can be defined as the inability to adequate your place for being warmer in the winter or cooler in the summer. This is a number from 2006. This is the last number about people facing energy insecurity. So with the financial crisis and climate change, probably the number went way higher. And this stat is way much more fresh. This came with a study last year and basically focuses on extreme heat in New York City. I started focusing on extreme cold when I arrived to the city and the program, and then I pivoted to extreme heat because basically my community showed to me that this was a more important issue. Some other facts, in some areas of the city, like South Bronx and Northern Manhattan, there's a lot of people who don't have an AC unit, and the numbers are pretty close to the numbers of people living below the poverty status. And these two areas in particular are heat pockets. What is a heat pocket? It's an area of the city that overheats more than the others because of a lack of green areas, because of wind dynamics, and also because of the condition of the buildings and the amount of concrete. If you live in a heat pocket and you can't cool your place, you are basically going to be baked the whole day inside your apartment, which is what happens to a lot of people. And basically, specifically the elder people and 5-year-olds, like from 5-year-olds to below 5-year-olds, they suffer the effects of extreme heat more than the rest of the people. Elder people can die of a heat stroke in the middle of a heat wave, and the kids can suffer asthma and get that condition for their whole life. So heat waves is the number one weather-related cause of deaths in the United States. It kills more people than hurricanes or floods, just for you two examples. And it's going to get worse. And this stat shows it particularly. It's particularly graphic about that. This is a New York State stat. So, and of course, this is less surprising, but this came last week. Of course, this is not a priority for the national government. And there's also some other issues related to this. And the top researcher in terms of energy insecurity told me that we, as with everything related to climate change, there's a framing issue. It's very tough to assign like a direct cause to this problematic. So it's very tough to, you know, face it and tackle it and generate and raise awareness about it. And then after we do that, we will be able to establish responsibilities and claim for solutions. I also learned quickly that there was a huge information gap. And I learned it by talking with Kevin and people like him, and also by reaching people working in public office and telling me, hey, people still don't know that there are some programs that might help them to get their place cooler. I spoke to some of them about the presence of a cooling assistance program, which basically allows you to get a free AC unit if you meet certain conditions. And people didn't even know about it. And even if they knew, they were skeptical about actually getting an AC unit. And this was one of my biggest findings through the year. While working on a data study, I learned that 75% of the New Yorkers who applied this year for the program couldn't get an AC unit. So I decided to try to help these people know more, to raise awareness about the issue, to let them know that this was a critical issue and that they could get help. So this was a very insular and diffuse community. Finding someone experiencing energy insecurity in New York City is like finding a needle in a haystack. It's a very diffuse community. It's not digitally prone. And there's also, of course, the lack of awareness component. How did I know this? My listening process included several interviews and conversations with researchers, the affected community organizers, and also I did some reporting, mostly data stories. I went to a lot of events, and I also went through a lot of research. And also, last but not least, I failed miserably by trying to find my community in digital platforms. And I did a couple of Facebook pages, and that didn't work. I couldn't find my community there. So I produced some stories. Some of those went to my publication in Medium called The Hidden Heat, and some others went to Adapt NY, which is an organization that I partner with, and I'm going to elaborate more about that later. These are some of my Medium posts and the metrics. Basically, not all of these posts are related to energy insecurity, like specifically, but I mentioned it like in every single one of them because I was describing the way I was approaching my community and getting close to it. So I think that in a way, these posts also helped me raise awareness about it. Surprisingly, I learned how to do video at least in a decent way. So I produced a lot of some videos. Got some views, and also I was honored by being a part of the CUNY Resilience Journalism Fellowship. It was the first year that the fellowship was started here in CUNY. Yeah, I'm really happy in that picture because I was with all those like pretty smart, really smart science journalists, and I learned a lot about how New York City tackles resilience issues and weather-related issues, either from policy and also from within the communities. And I developed some tools for my community. Specifically, I worked on a web application in which you can check if you are eligible for getting an AC unit. And you can see these are some of the slides. And also, I did a postcard journalism project that is aimed to the community. And this is your Hidden Heat is probably the biggest project that I involved with, or the most important at least, because it tries to find people at their homes. Energy issues are very personal and deep issues and intimate ones. And I wanted them to have something that they really would like to have in their homes, to give it as a present for some other neighbors. And of course, the postcards have some information about these issues, but also it includes an invitation to a platform in which I want this community to be together and to be able to connect with each other and help each other. So I wanted to do something for the community, but with the community. And while I was doing this, I was starting to work with Adapt NY as a community editor. And they had in mind a neighbor-to-neighbor project. And so in a way, I started to contribute to that. And I helped them to you know, with the outreach process and to reach some communities. And in a way, if we are going to make a neighbor-to-neighbor network in Northern Manhattan, in which people are going to be able to help each other and communicate with each other and be alerted about heat waves, we need a lot of people. So we act as a partner of AdaptNY. They work in the Harlem Heat project last year, which is a project focused on measuring temperature, indoor temperatures inside Northern Manhattan homes. And now they are taking the next step by doing the neighbor-to-neighbor network. So basically, my work overlap with that. So I learned that resilience is not just a matter of policy. And while being a community editor, for AdaptNY, I reach 8 organizations that might be inclined to reach to be a part of this neighbor-to-neighbor network in the future. And this is my estimation, but probably we are going to reach like a bigger amount of people. So my final takes about my experience is that resilience issues, as this one that I was trying to tackle and help people with, demand understanding from policy making, but also from within the community, experimenting a lot, and prevention. We cannot help them when the heat wave hits the area. It also demands using the community skills and motivation. We need buy-in from inside the communities. And I learned through this year that through my whole career, I wanted to get sources. I work to get sources to that give me information. And now I know that if I'm going to be a social journalist, I need partners, people that can elevate what I do and help me reach the community in a different way. So that's pretty much it. Thank you so much.
Hey, woo. Good work, Sebastian. You know, we're Social J, so we believe in questions and engagement, but we also want to keep this moving because we have 13 people here. So the Twitter handles are on all of the programs that I passed out. We definitely encourage you to engage that way, and then we'll also have some time afterwards. If you can stay and have a drink with us, you can ask these guys more individual questions then. So, all right, right on. All right, Jennifer. Merry-go-round, living life on the merry-go-round, and you can't find a fighter.
Groff, and for the last year, I have been working to serve the anti-trafficking community and survivors of sex trafficking. So this woman, I met her recently teaching a workshop. Her name is Vanji, and on the surface, back in the day, many people would have labeled her as a prostitute. But the truth is that she's a survivor of sex trafficking, and her story is much like most of women who are impacted by this social injustice. The difference with her story that contradicts what you may have seen in movies and on mainstream media is that she wasn't forced, she wasn't kidnapped, she was never changed to a bed. But she was emotionally manipulated and emotionally abused by someone she loved and cared for, to the point that she was forced to sell her body on this street corner to meet her trafficker's quota. If she did not meet her trafficker's quota, she would face extreme abuse, threats to her family, including her own child. So I was very much inspired by her story. Because she was never rescued. In fact, it was her desire to live, her perseverance and resilience that rescued herself from this horrible situation and got herself on the road to recovery. So this is her story from the workshop. So when it comes to sex trafficking, we have a lot of issues. These are just a few. The overlap of the commercial sex trade and sex trafficking creates a policing conundrum. Oftentimes, police aren't able to identify a victim of trafficking versus a person that's willingly engaging in sex work. You also have legislation that victimizes survivors and an overwhelming need for services to help with rehabilitation, stable shelter, and living wages. So the big question that I faced is, what can social journalism do to impact sex trafficking? It took a lot of listening from my community to figure that out because I was inundated with a lot of information and a lot of problems. But through listening, I was able to come up with that we need to stop being the voice for the voiceless and amplify survivors' voices and engaging them to tell their own stories. The next was to elevate empathy and reduce stigma around prostitution, because often these women are facing a lot of unwelcome behavior from people that could potentially help them. Then, deepening awareness beyond the stereotypical narratives, and this can best be done on where people get their news and information, through social platforms and using multimedia. And then last, because social journalism is a service, I want to report the stories that meet unmet needs. So how did I engage my community? Well, I decided to create a workshop, and this is a page from my workbook. So I taught a creative writing workshop that introduced survivors to tools that can empower them to tell their own story. And then I would crowdsource survivor stories and share them on social media. Then I realized after the first workshop that I kind of leave the room, and now the connection to my community no longer existed. There was no way to talk to them again, and I live here in New York and they're in Ohio. So I created a Google Voice number that was local and accessible to them using a landline to serve as a listening post to keep the communication open. And then for engagement, I developed a website called righttobeheard.us. I invite you to visit it. However, I created the workshop early on in the semester, and that was really before understanding that my community has an access to technology barrier. But I'll come back to that later. Then I created a tool to go on the website that would help a person that was a victim of trafficking understand how could this happen to them. So there's a research study that shows that adverse childhood experiences, if you have 4 out of 10, you're very likely to face significant impact later in life. And then last, the next story, this is where survivors can reach out to me and let me know their reporting needs, and I would try to report the story along with them. So, and I just want to mention that there are 3 stages to surviving trafficking. You have a victim who's potentially still in the life. You have survivors who are on their way to recovery, and you have thrivers, and they're living more stable lives at this point. So my different ways of engaging them varied by which stage they're on, we're at. So where I kind of got inspired for my practicum was in Kensington, Philadelphia, where I went to a drop-in center. As you can see here, this is where the drop-in center was located on this street. It was actually the entrance underneath an XXX video shop, so the irony could not be lost. And then I learned that they practice an art for self-expression. So every week, the women are invited voluntarily to join a group where they explore painting and different ways of expressing themselves through art for therapy. And the entire walls of the drop-in center were covered with their work, and you could tell they're really proud of it. And this was my inspiration for the creative writing workshop. So I got on a plane and I flew to Columbus, Ohio, never been there before, and then also to Bangor, Maine, which is about 3 hours north from when I used to live in Portland, so that was a new experience too. I taught 2 workshops, 6 were offered, 13 attendees, and 11 stories compiled. This is one of the venues for the Bangor, Maine workshop. So my premise, my foundation for the workshop was to have the participants start to explore telling their story through a challenge that Ernest Hemingway did, where he was asked to tell a story in 6 words. And it was actually pretty powerful to see what the women came up with. These are their stories. You can see more at Right to Be Heard on Instagram. sorry. So to amplify their voices, I chose the platform Instagram because I just thought it was a powerful way to add impact. It's a short story with an image, so that was my preferred medium. And then, like I said, to engage my community and keep the conversation going, I started this listening post that overcame the access to technology. Workshop participants can tell more stories, and then the next phase is using ITTT to take the transcribed stories on Google voicemail and then tweeting them out to the Right to Be Heard Twitter channel so that they have remote but some access to social media. This is the website that I created in the first semester. Now that I've learned a little bit more about the community that I've been working with, I realized that this would be good for survivors that have long been thriving. So I would invite them to come here and share resources for other survivors or to join a community with other thrivers. And then to keep the conversation going about sex trafficking by letting me know what stories they would like me to report on. And then the other tool on that website, which I mentioned earlier, was something we did in design that used coding to make a calculator out of the adverse childhood experience research study. So people would ask 10 questions about their childhood. If they answered 4 or more, it would direct them to how this may have negatively impacted them and made them vulnerable to being trafficked. So I tried to engage the anti-trafficking community, more of the people working in service providing. And I posted stories on Medium, some Twitter and Facebook activity. So there's that. And to continue, again, to report on the unmet needs of the community, I focused on policing prostitution. And I requested 10 years of data from the Department of Justice Services, Criminal Services, DCJS. And I analyzed that data at a different couple points, and I learned that 77% of women arraigned for prostitution in Queens are Asian, and I started to research and try to figure out why. And I learned that traffickers leverage immigration status. Victims don't often disclose to police because of Stockholm syndrome and cultural barriers. And then we ultimately would hope for a paradigm shift where we don't arrest women in the sex trade, but that we go after buyers. So at the end of this journey, I was really excited to get the community feedback that survivors are still talking about the workshop to this day. And when somebody apparently says 6 words that are relevant to their story, someone announced, that's a 6-word story, and began teaching them how they could write a 6-word story. And then the survivors themselves, after 8 years of going to the well, she had never enjoyed a workshop so much. It's been her favorite, so that was really encouraging. And then Deidre asked if I can come back, which I would love to do. So thank you, and this is how you can reach me. We gon' walk it out and
hi, I'm Melissa DePento. I've taught as an adjunct journalism professor for 5 years, and I'm here to talk tonight about how we can reinvent J-School. So diversity in newsrooms, we know that this is an issue that's been ongoing, and according to recent statistics, mainstream newsrooms have not been improving much. 69% of the Washington Post newsroom is white. 81% of the New York Times newsroom is white. And 81% of the Wall Street Journal newsroom is also white. A more diverse newsroom, from what I've learned and listened to this year, starts in the classroom. So imagine a newsroom whose staff actually reflects the communities they intend to serve and cover through their reporting. We might have stories that look a little bit more like this. So over here we have a story from Nicole Hannah Jones of the New York Times, where she talks intimately about the struggle she had finding a school for her daughter in segregated New York City. And here, this is an image of a piece from Philadelphia reporter Peek Johnson, who is a native of North Philly, and he covers urban issues and incarceration and other things. So there are many barriers of entry for students of color who wish to pursue journalism. And through listening this year, I've come to a better understanding of these barriers that exist. So a little bit about how I met educators this year. So my main entry point was by hosting EdShift chats on Twitter. So these are monthly chats on Twitter where I gather educators to talk about certain issues. We've talked about accreditation, diversity, and more. So this has given me a great entry point into knowing, not only expanding my circle of educators, but also getting to know issues in a deeper way. I've also continued to connect with educators on Twitter. I've started conversations in two Facebook groups where journalism educators convene. So these groups are the ONA Educators Group and the Disruptive Journalism Educators Network. I've also connected with educators through my work here at the Town Knight Center. I've met with professors on campus. I've interviewed them over the phone. I've met with many of you at conferences like ONA, and also through my role as an adjunct journalism professor this semester at Brooklyn College. And lastly, I've also gotten to know issues educators care about through surveys that I've created. So here's a little bit about what I've heard from educators about how to make journalism education a bit more inclusive. Members of the community have said creating diversity scholarships, hiring a more diverse faculty, and recruiting outside of who applies. Other ideas that have been promoted, introducing high school students to journalism, paying for student internships, reevaluating tenure, and introducing students to journalists of color. It didn't feel like a place I'd ever see myself at. So this is one of the heartbreaking comments from one of my students this semester at Brooklyn College. She told me that her class recently visited the New York Times and she simply didn't identify with anyone in the newsroom. So these are a few reasons why I created the Diversity in J Schools chat. So here's a screenshot. It's currently a Slack channel, and this is promoted as a safe place for educators to discuss diversity and inclusivity in journalism schools. So this is actually the second iteration of this project. Initially, I had started it on another platform that I was beta testing, and the response that I got from educators and participants was that the user experience wasn't very good. So this was an instance of needing to listen to the community and pivot, and this is how I arrived at the second iteration of this, and we're giving it a try. So a lot of social journalism, I believe, is reaching out to the community, starting and creating, taking feedback and moving on if something doesn't quite work right. So a little bit about why I felt the Diversity in J Schools chat would be effective. So as I mentioned, I've been talking to a lot of educators this year, and this was coming up constantly, the need for diversity in J Schools. Another promising thing was I started a conversation in one of the Facebook groups, and over 85 educators and others commented saying that they were interested in starting a conversation on diversity. So this gave me the courage to launch this as a project and get the community involved because I was hearing that educators were ready to take action when it comes to diversity. So this is just one of the two programs in Reinventing J School, which is the hub I created to serve journalism educators. Here's just a little screenshot of the website. So in my listening, I also heard that educators are doing whatever they can to stay up to date. This is inherent to their jobs. So again, I'm trying to imagine a world, what journalism educators across the world could do when they join forces to tackle new challenges together. So this is what led me to create the second part of my project, Academic Allies. So Academic Allies currently is a Google form. Educators elect, they sign up, they answer a few questions. They elect to be paired up with another educator. So they can elect to either be matched up with a peer or perhaps they're interested in a mentor or mentee relationship. So again, using this feedback from the community, I was talking to educators, hearing that staying up to date is critical to their jobs. I also pitched this idea in one of the groups where educators convene, the ONA Educators Group. I feel like I can't say educators enough. So here, in pitching this idea, I had about 20 or so people comment saying, yeah, that's a great idea. I would love to have this kind of resource. So again, this gave me the courage to push forward and at least create something. So in thinking of these two ideas, both diversity and the challenge that educators have in staying up to date, if we don't do these in journalism, higher education, and if academia fails to prepare the next generation of journalists for the challenges ahead, many people in this community think journalism education is doomed. So just the other day, Neiman recently released a report, a 2018 predictions report. So one professor from Texas State, Cindy Royal, her predictions are in here, and she's talking about what journalism schools can do to tweak and refine their programs. Because here she says, otherwise, students will begin to flee from their programs and seek out other degrees at their universities or a more innovative degree at other schools. So this is the challenge we face in journalism higher education. This is a real threat and also a chance for a lot of opportunity to change things. Again, I can't stress enough, it's a critical time for journalism education, and what we do today has an impact on what tomorrow looks like. So here's a few more metrics which have guided some of the decisions I've made. So here, I know this is a little tough to see, but this is a survey that I co-wrote with some of the Town Night folks here at CUNY. And one of the most important things, we launched this survey at the ONA conference. 68 educators participated in this. One of the most important things educators said was that they need to stay up to date and that this is a critical part of their jobs and what they think about most. And then over here, a few of the comments are about diversity, and people specifically in this survey pulled that out and expressed interest in creating more conversation around diversity. So these are some of the metrics that have helped lead me to continue to push for these programs. I've also kept writing Medium posts throughout the year. So I was writing pretty regularly this semester each week. And oftentimes, I think this is a hard challenge. I'm not always creative. I don't always have something interesting to say. But I think as social journalists, we owe it to ourselves to talk about the process we've taken to arrive at what we've created. So I tried to do that. I tried to show the good and the bad, what worked, what didn't work. So one of the little screenshots up here is a piece that I wrote about a failed Kickstarter campaign that I had launched, and I talk about some of the challenges with that and what I learned. So again, I think advice for future social journalists is to explain your process and show what you're doing, feed that back to the community, and look for insight from them and allow them to help shape what you create. So lastly, just to wrap up, 19 educators have signed up for Academic Allies. I'm in the process of pairing up these educators and plan to share resources, inspiration, and more with them in the near future. 15 educators have signed up for the Diversity in J Schools chat. And lastly, 100%. I am 100% ready for change in the J School classroom. So please join me. Thank you.
Listen to the song more. I love it. Thank you. Hi, everyone. My name is Victoria Isabel Munch. I'm from Germany. Currently, I'm an intern at RACT, which is at Vox Media. And to start us off, I would like for you guys to imagine a scenario. So imagine a person that you love and that you trust and that you think loves you and that trusts you. And imagine how you would feel if that person told you that you're ugly, or that you're stupid, or that you're worthless. And imagine if that person told you this not just once, but every day. And also in combination with controlling behavior, manipulation, maybe yelling or threats or gaslighting. This behavior is emotional abuse. And that's the community I decided to focus on this year. Emotional abuse is a crime, is real. And just because it doesn't involve physical violence doesn't mean it's not, you know, it's not a crime or, yeah. So I chose to work with this community because of a personal experience that I had. And when I was going through it, it took me about 2 years to really realize that what I was experiencing was actually abuse. And that is what a lot of victims do as well. So experts I've talked to, social workers and psychologists, and they said that the most common type of abuse is actually emotional abuse, but it's also the least researched type. And the reason for that is victims, like I said, don't realize it right away, and that therefore don't seek help right away. And then there's just not really a lot of talk about it. And when we look at stuff like domestic violence or even sexual harassment, which is talked about obviously right now a lot, there's stats. These are two right here from the National Domestic Violence Hotline. There's 24 reports a minute of domestic violence and 12 million reports a year. But when you try to find stats like that for emotional abuse, you come up really with pretty much nothing. And that's where I saw the issue. And I wanted to change that a little bit this year. So my goal was, or I gave myself two jobs. The first one was to make those victims who are going through it and who don't realize that they're going through it aware that they can seek help. And the other job was to connect those victims that are aware of it to helpful resources. So in social journalism, the first thing we learned was that building trust and showing empathy with your community is like the most important thing. And you need to engage with your community and then really dive in and listen and observe and see what you as a journalist can do to help them and to serve them. So I started off by building trust, and I shared my own story publicly. I wrote a Medium post, and it actually did pretty well. It was featured on Medium's main front page back in February, and was part of the Bat Romance collection. So that was really nice to get that initial feedback and like push into the community. And then I obviously, like my classmates, will spend time meeting and interacting with victims online and in person. I was part of Facebook groups, and I went to support groups, and I was really trying to spend time to observe like what they were posting, what questions they had, what like the main themes were of the things they were talking about. And by doing that, I found three main needs that this community has, which is information, safety, and comfort. Information meaning like, how do you defend yourself in court? How does emotional abuse relate to the law? Are there even laws in the US? Or how do you spot an abuser? How does somebody even become an abuser? What kind of mental disorders are part of being an abuser? And then safety, just being basically having a place where they can share their stories without being worried about their abuser finding out, or just like basically finding other fellow victims. And comfort meaning they need to know how to cope with the results of emotional abuse, which can include depression, it can include low self-confidence, and even suicidal thoughts. So really, you know, very serious consequences. So I let this basically inspire me to, or inspire my content. So I also made a Medium publication where it's published 12 pieces. I also started a podcast where victims can anonymously share their stories, and I also invited a social worker to kind of answer some questions. I made PSA videos because part of this whole initiative for me was to raise awareness. And I felt like PSA videos were kind of an interesting way to do that. I also made an online hub and an online magazine. So PSA videos, this is one that I filmed a couple weeks ago. It was kind of an experiment. It's called How Do You Define Abuse? And I basically wanted to see I basically wanted to push out the message that abuse doesn't have to be physical. And I wanted to make people think about the different ways of abuse. I can't show you all of it. I can only show you a minute. So this starts like in the middle. Thank you. and it goes on. So yeah, that was a really fun experience because I didn't know, like I said, how it was going to work turn out. But people actually stopped, and then some even shared their own stories. So that was a really interesting way to just basically talk to strangers about their personal, really toxic experiences. So yeah, what's happening? Okay. So yeah, then the hub is basically like a website where I compile everything that I did. It has all of the stories I made, all of the podcasts and videos, and also has a quiz where people who aren't sure if they're, what they're experiencing is abuse can answer questions, and then it tells them whether or not they should consider getting help or not. I got good feedback, which is obviously really rewarding to see when people tell you that your heart's in the right place and you're using your skills to help people, or that my work has become a lifeline for many survivors and has impacted a lot of lives. It's just nice to hear that actually what I've spent my year doing helped some people. On Medium, my stories as of yesterday have been viewed a little over 1,100 times, which is really cool for me. I made a Facebook page as well that has about 175 likes, and I also sent out a survey earlier this year that got 21 responses. And I looked at my top three stories on Medium, and they were my testimony and a story I wrote on proving emotional abuse in court, and 100 self-care ideas to improve your life after abuse. And those three kind of represent the three needs that I had recognized in the beginning. So that was kind of cool to see that connection there. Moving forward, obviously this is a personal thing for me. So I want to keep building a community, keep raising awareness. There's still so much that needs to be done. And push for education, because that's really where this all is coming from. There's not enough education. So yeah, if you have any questions or want to contact me, this is my page or my website. If I go, for a little while longer. Tell me what you really like. Maybe I could take my time. We don't ever have to fight. Just take it step by step. I can see it in your eyes, 'cause they never tell me lies. I can feel that body shake and the heat between your legs. You've been scared of love and what it did to you. You don't have to run. Touch and it can set you free. We don't have to rush when you're alone with me.
Hello, everyone. My name is Rita Bensliman, and I've spent the last year serving international students living and studying in the United States. I have to admit, when I first entered the social journalism program, I came in with a bit of an ego. I'm an international student myself. I'm from Morocco, and so I'm actually one of the more than a million international students currently enrolled in the last academic year. And so I began my year thinking I knew what international students needed because I knew what I needed, which was visibility. I had gone through the process of being an international student. I did my undergrad at Boston University, and so I went through the process. And I came into the Social J program wanting to show everyone the challenges faced by international students, about all the different immigration processes that we have to learn about to be able to enter and to be able to work on campus or obtain a job after we graduate. And so I also wanted to show the public about how U.S. immigration and labor laws are basically built to attract international students to invest approximately $39 billion in the U.S. economy every year and swiftly send us back home. So I remember asking this question to my professors, Carrie Brown and Jeff Jarvis, in our community engagement class, our first semester, and that question was, if what a community needs is visibility, isn't giving them that visibility a form of service? And so you can see how I sort of twisted that in order to be able to convince my professors to just produce the content that I want. I wanted to make videos, I wanted to write articles about my community, and you know what I realized and what they said essentially was, nice try, but no. Social journalism is about a lot more than that. It's about finding out about your community's needs and trying to find ways to serve those needs. And so I started from scratch, and I did something that sadly and unfortunately is being considered something that's innovative and groundbreaking in journalism, which is, you know, listening. And I asked international students what they needed and what they wanted to learn about and what they needed from the journalism industry. So in order to do that, I interviewed more than 50 international students outside of schools, in person, on camera, on the phone. I filmed Vicky, who's also an international student from Germany. I bribed students with donuts outside of Columbia University, and it worked. And what I found out, I got three major insights from all of this journalism work. One of my major insights was that many international students want to stay after graduating. Of all the international students that I spoke to throughout the course of my research, none of them said that they wanted to return home right after school. Many said that they wanted to gain professional experience for at least a few years before returning back home. And a lot of them also said, you know, I want to just stay here and build my life here. And actually, according to the International Education Institute, the number of students staying on after graduation has risen by 19%. In the last academic year, indicating an increased interest in obtaining a career experience post-grad. I also found out that international students are ill-informed when it comes to the work and immigration procedures that apply to them. So when you come in as an international student, you're constantly faced with all these acronyms. And if you don't know what any of these mean, don't worry, because international students also don't know what this means a lot of the time as well. And just to give you guys a quick primer as we move forward in this presentation, for example, a normal college student wants to intern somewhere to gain a career experience. Polish your resume, write a few cover letters, send it out, go to interviews, get your internship. An international student has to apply for this form of work authorization called CPT. They have to get permission from their advisor, get permission from the international's office, and then convince their employer that it's worth it to hire an international student to be an intern, even though they probably will have difficulty hiring them after, and we'll go into that as well later. And H-1B also, if you want to intern, you get CPT, Curricular Practical Training. If you want to work after school as an international student, you have to apply for something called OPT. You hear this all the time as an international student, OPT, OPT, OPT. It means Optional Practical Training. And so they put that word optional in there to try and like dissuade you from going. It's optional. You can stay and get a career experience, or you can go back home. It's fine. And so you have to apply for that 3 months before you graduate. And a lot of international students find it hard to obtain jobs on OPT because a lot of the times it lasts 1 year, unless you're a STEM graduate. If you have a degree in a science, tech, engineering, or math field, then you get a 2-year extension, a 3-year OPT permit, and that changes everything. But if, like most students who only have 1 year, if you do want to stay and gain more experience after that, you have to apply for another work visa. And these two at the bottom are two types of work visas. H-1B non-immigrant work visa is the most popular work visa amongst international students hoping to stay. It's a lottery-based program, which essentially means if a company wants to hire you as a foreigner and keep you, they have to apply for this specialty occupation visa. They have to convince the U.S. government that they have to hire you over an American. And then the application goes through the U.S. Immigration Service, and it's run through a random selection, and you either get it or you don't. I myself didn't get it. I went through that process and I didn't get it as well. I also found out that those seeking H-1B sponsorship, they want to find an easy way to find out which companies sponsor for H-1Bs. You're graduating, it's your last year of school, and you're trying to figure out which companies to apply to, which will be worth it for you to like sit down and write a cover letter. So that's something that I've been getting a lot in my research. So I formed an action plan. I figured out that, you know, during my practicum, I was going to continue the visibility and explainer work, something that I initially set out to do. I thought that was still important. There is value in creating, publishing stories and in making videos and trying to get that the word out there. I also decided that I was going to create a bi-weekly email newsletter called Students with Borders. And no, that is not a reference to Doctors with Borders, but a reference to the various immigration procedures that international students have to navigate during their time here. And you can find that at studentswithborders.tilda.ws. And I'll go into that a little bit in a minute. I also decided that I would create an H-1B sponsor search tool. I would try and find all the data for companies that have tried to sponsor international students for H-1B work visas and get that on a website. And that's at dothaysponsor.com. I bought the domain, but it's still not attached to the domain. Don't check it out just yet. I will show you a demo, though. So my visibility work, so I created a Medium publication called International Students of New York. I wrote stories about different international students. I wrote a profile about an international student called Suhail, who is a journalist in exile from Iran, and his student visa is running up, and if he can't find a work visa, then, you know, if he goes back to Iran, he gets jailed. If he goes back to Germany, where he has, you know, refugee status, he doesn't speak German. So it's just the kind of situations that international students sometimes find themselves in. I wrote H-1B explainers. I also made a video about how international students themselves feel about the H-1B work visa, for example. And so I'll show you a quick snippet. You might recognize some of these students. They're CUNY J students.
That's bullshit.
Oh, shoot.
Can I say that? Okay, well, it's bullshit.
Sorry, the audio is like... Woo. Oh, there it is. Sorry. Obviously.
That's bullshit. Can I say that? Okay, well, it's bullshit.
H-1B, it's the most common, I would say, vast majority of the work visas are H-1B category.
I know that the H-1B is necessary for me to continue working in the United States after my OPT period.
It takes time, it takes money, and a lot of patience and luck because it's also through a lottery. So it's really nerve-wracking.
It is a lottery. There's a chance that you may not get through, which makes companies even more apprehensive to invest money and time because you spend all that cash and you don't get through. What's the sense?
Personally, I think that the H-1B, running a lottery, it's an offense to everybody in this process because I believe that each applicant needs to be judged on their merits, not on the chances or, like, you know, luck.
Part of my visibility work, set up an Instagram account called International Students of New York. It's modeled after Humans of New York. And so within that channel, my goal was to, A, give visibility to international students and give them a platform to talk about their experiences, and also to be able to interview international students and find out more about their needs. So this is, for example, an international student from Morocco. Her name is Kenza Mandri. She writes about, she says, the reality of it is that most employers won't give international graduates a chance when they can give it to an American graduate, given the costs associated with sponsorship. And then, so then the second goal of my practicum, creating this newsletter, it's called Students with Borders. It goes out every 2 weeks. I provide different guides, news updates. I feature different students and student writing. I give students the opportunity to submit questions. And then, you know, with the website that I mentioned earlier, I found all this data on the labor certification registry of the U.S. Department of Labor website. And just to show you a little snippet, if you want to know, for example, which company sponsor, you can go on the site and, for example, Vox Media, and it tells you, based on all the data that we have for H-1Bs, in the 2016 fiscal year, this is what Vox, this is who Vox sponsored, the New York Times, they sponsored data engineers. So it kind of gives you a sense of what kinds of roles are being sponsored. And then, this is just a few more slides. I measured my impact. You know, my impact, my numbers aren't like they're not great in terms of what you would traditionally consider as amazing impact-driven metrics. But I measured my impact in terms of what people were telling me in the comment section. Like, thank you, I wish I had access to that while in the US in reference to my newsletter. Or, preach, this is exactly my struggle right now. Or someone saying, you know, student Constanza sent me that, that the newsletter was a great resource. I also, through my work, was able to build the International Students Organization and build a community here at the school, which has been amazing. And so, yeah, thank you so much for listening, and feel free to contact me at...
trying to get you high, fade it off this touch. You don't need a lonely night.
Party song, so don't blame them for. I mean, they got to pick it, but it's my fault. But what? Yeah, I know. Yeah.
Joe. Hey everybody, my name is Max Resnick, and I am one of the members of this year's social journalism class. This year I've been studying and learning with and from the members of New York City's community and ethnic media producers, editors, reporters, and more. Today is December 13th, but to provide a little context, I thought we should go back in time a little bit. 1927. The New York Herald Tribune. A fantastic paper published daily with pages and pages of stories, national, local, international. Sewer jobs were fraudulent. You'd have convicts using brass knuckles to escape from Sing Sing prison. Fascists fighting anti-fascists. Meanwhile, uptown, there's the New York Amsterdam News, which is the longest running, one of the longest running African-American papers in the country. And they would report on stories that were much more important to the local community up there. And it was 20 pages of stories. It was a robust paper. It would have things like the society pages, where you would describe who would be coming to visit who was visiting from out of town, what was going on in the neighborhood. All of these papers were supported by pages and pages of local advertising. Really strong information about everything from fur-lined coats to new Frigidaires and beauty products. December 13th, 2017, the New York Herald Tribune, you are sitting in it. It is no longer around. This building that we're in is the former headquarters of it. It's gone. It doesn't exist anymore. The New York Amsterdam News, however, is still producing news, and it's still reporting on issues that are important to the community. You have stories about Colin Kaepernick visiting Rikers Island, racism in the workplace, and more. Local news is wildly, wildly important for New Yorkers. It's a massive city, 8 million people, dozens of community districts where you have local representatives who are producing legislation and laws that affect your life, your business opportunities. And in New York City, recently we've had lots of struggles with sustainability. DNA Info, which was a neighborhood-by-neighborhood news website that provided jobs and opportunities for many recent graduates, their reporters voted to unionize a little bit over a month ago, and their organization was shut down. Brookliner last week put out an ultimatum to their supporters saying that if they don't get 3,000 people to subscribe, pay to subscribe to their paper, they're going to cease publication by the end of the year. For many of these neighborhoods and for people who are living there, these local news organizations are the only information that you get about what's going on in your community. If I were just, you know, my parents get information about what's going on in New York City, and it sounds like everything that's happening is either crimes or cows on the loose in Prospect Park. But there's much more important information about local businesses, local opportunities, jobs, and what your neighbors are doing. Local newspapers give you a sense of place, give you a sense of your own personal history and your connection to your neighbors. There are more than 300 publications throughout New York City publishing in more than 30 languages. Nearly half of all New Yorkers report speaking a language other than English in their homes. If you're a city the size of New York and you're having to provide opportunities and things like education, small business loans, everything. You need to be able to translate and provide this information to the communities that need this. And if you don't have local papers to be able to direct that information to those communities, people are not going to find out what's going on. And if these local papers are not staying, are not thriving and are not surviving, then that vital channel of information is gone. New York City has so many different languages. And if you look at this map, you can see neighborhood by neighborhood, there is some consistency, but there are many different languages that are spoken within neighborhoods. And so news organizations provide essential services, translating information from the city council, from local community boards to people who are living in those neighborhoods. It's a big challenge. There are one of the things that inspired me to start this project at the beginning of this year, my colleague Jessica, who you'll hear from in a couple of presenters, ran her own local paper here in New York in the 90s. And what she told me, and it stuck with me, was that there are 51 community districts in New York City, and each of them have populations that are the size of, like, larger than my hometown of Burlington, Vermont, populations of 50 to 200,000 people. Each of those community districts has enough people to be able to support a local news institution, to be able to cover information and provide information about what's going on in your neighborhood. I've been really lucky to be able to not have to travel around and wrangle all these different different producers, because here at CUNY we have the Center for Community and Ethnic Media, which is a fantastic organization which provides trainings for journalists. It brings in local officials and public officials to be able to provide opportunities for members of the press to ask them questions one-on-one, and they do so much more. Karen, who's right here, is one of the directors of the center. Over the course of this year, I've been to around a dozen events that they've produced. Workshops in broadcast journalism, mobile filmmaking, newsmaker series with commissioners of city agencies, as well as events at the city council. At these meetings, at these trainings, I've done everything from teach people how to use their phones to take photos. I've documented the events, and I've done some translation too. Helping people who are not as comfortable in English to be able to ask questions about how some of the technology can be used. This is a thriving sector of the local news ecosystem here in New York City, and I feel really lucky to have been able to be here at CUNY where people come together to do this stuff. Some of the pictures that I took from a virtual reality training were used in a grant application that brought $27,000 to the school to be able to continue to provide these kinds of trainings and to be able to report back on how virtual reality can be used for local publications. Really cool. I see a lot of opportunities for organizations and schools like CUNY and other journalism schools to connect to members of the local press. There's a huge opportunity for students who are coming up to be able to place stories and to learn really how a community gets information through the local press. There were several events here in the city that I went to where people gathered, such as the IPPI Awards here at the school. I helped run the tech and coordinate speakers for the Latino Media Summit here. And then when I wasn't at school, I went to places where members of my community were not able to attend. Conferences on collaborative journalism in New Jersey, and on publishing that utilizes the power of communities, I went to Chicago for that. And I learned about innovative ways that news organizations across the country are tapping into local people who are interested in getting involved in the creation of news and in helping local reporters to cover events that they wouldn't be able to cover on their own. One of the places where I've been starting to put this what I've learned into practice is the Mott Haven Herald. The Mott Haven Herald is a monthly print paper that serves people in the South Bronx, and as well they run a news website. It's a thriving community up there. It's one of the poorest congressional districts in the country, and if you were to read most mainstream news stories, the only thing that happens up there is crime. That's obviously not true. There's thriving arts organizations, people who are running fabulous small businesses, interesting educational opportunities, and people who are engaged. The last community board meeting that I went to up there was packed with people. There were not even enough seats to have members of the public who wanted to talk with their community representatives. The paper also serves here at the school as a place for journalism students to provide information and to do reporting that will go out to the community. One of the things that I'm building out on with the Listening Post Collective, which is an organization that provides information about how to make your reporting reflective of what a community needs to know. Working with them on how to use the Mott Haven Herald as an example of syllabus creation and how to weave some of these projects, everything that my classmates have been working on, how to weave some of that stuff into how journalism students are learning about reporting about their communities. So the next steps, in the new year, we're going to be developing a community advisory board for the Herald, working on the syllabus integration, and redoing the website. Many local publications are still running their websites as PDFs of their print papers because local advertising is so lucrative. Upcoming projects, there's translation tools, there's so much good stuff. I'm really excited to do it, but I'm getting the timer. So, oh my goodness, bird's eye, oh man. There's so many opportunities here. I'm really excited. And here's how to get in touch with me. Thanks, everybody.
I did warn them that I would lurk toward the end. I'm just lurking, you know. I'm not that mean, though. I haven't tackled anybody. I just lurk ominously.
Hi. How's everybody doing? I'm officially the seventh person, so you are halfway through. Congratulations, you've made it this far. My name is Maria Fraschilla, and I decided to focus on athletes with mental illness. So when I got accepted to the program, I sat down with Carrie Brown and Marissa Sorio, and I sat there and I droned on and on and on about, like, this is what I've done, this is what I want to do. What community do you want to focus on? I was like, health and wellness, sure, cool, awesome. And Carrie looked at me with a smile and she said, we've never had anyone focus on health and wellness before. So I was like, I know that this is where I belong. So mental illness community is a very, very, very important community to me. I'm a competitive powerlifter, but I also suffer from depression and anxiety. So I know the issues that come along with this. So what is this? What is crushing PRs? A PR is a personal record or a personal best. Athletes crush those in the gym, in their swim meets, in their running races. It's a big deal. So Crushing PRs is a Medium publication dedicated to athletes, by athletes, for athletes, stories profiling them, sharing resources, and really just sharing the stories. So if these athletes celebrate their physical PRs, why don't we celebrate the mental ones as well? So what's the problem? 1 in 5 Americans in the United States suffer from mental illness, according to the National Alliance of Mental Illness. So the stigma is pretty high. Athletes are meant to be strong physically and mentally, so asking for help is few and far between. So how do we solve this? We defeat the stigma, we start the conversation. Who are we targeting? Athletes, of all stature. Professional, collegiate, amateur, disabled, any race, gender, age, sport, it doesn't matter. But we're not just targeting those athletes. We're targeting their coaches. We're targeting their family members. We're targeting their athletic trainers, their teachers, faculty, staff, anyone that's with these people day to day so they know how to help them. So what now? Let's start the conversation. Let's talk to the community. Talk to the professionals. Let's just talk. So how do we reach these athletes? We don't just walk into a gym and say, hey, who's depressed? Let's talk. Social media. Every platform, medium.com, which had 1.26 million views in the last 6 months, YouTube series, vloggers, Instagram videos, personal essays. I realized that in order to show my community who I am, I need to relate to them and show them that I understand that their troubles are important. And surveys, it's Social J, we gotta listen. What do they actually wanna know about? How many of you have a social media profile? Yeah, every hand should be up. So 81% of the U.S. population has a social media profile, and this is the main place I've had success reaching amateur athletes, whether it's searching hashtags like Fitspiration or powerlifting or track and field or just coming across them on the Explore page. This is where I've seen the most, I guess, traction. So who's Bradley Martin? He is a 6'3 behemoth. He deadlifts over 700 pounds. He's very big in the health and wellness industry. He's a bodybuilder. Why is he in a hospital bed? Bradley had a panic attack and thought he was having a heart attack. So he decided to post a 45-minute YouTube vlog after the fact, share this photo, and tell people anxiety is something that everyone deals with. It's no joke. So as you can see, anxiety is a bitch, obviously. And people are commenting, you know, this is very real and I admire it. Thank you for being so honest in a world where people aren't. This is how you make an impact. Sarah Ramadan, she is a bodybuilder, but in 2014, she was on the brink of death from anorexia. Her late brother got her into bodybuilding and showed her a fitness regimen and nutritional guidelines, and she's overcome it and has become a staple in the anorexia recovery movement. As you can see, thank you for sharing this. You're a fighter. You're so beautiful. Can't imagine how much strength it took, but thank you. Allison M. Desir is from Harlem. She's a runner. Her dad passed away, and she was fighting with depression, so she started using the hashtag #FindMeaningOnTheRun, and she started a bunch of running communities and really decided to show people, you know, you're not alone. And as you can see, we're never alone because we run together. Keep being you. So now getting to my Medium publication. I wrote 12 pieces, 2,200 views, 1,100 reads, 51 fans, and my personal Medium has 682 followers. So I got to hit the community pretty hard. I wrote pieces that were investigative, that dealt with student athletes and concussions and their general health and wellness, athlete profiles on powerlifters who struggle with depression. I've talked to a lot of people, and these are just some of the statements of impact and feedback that I received, which was overwhelmingly positive. And then I was also featured on The Sports Walk, which is a YouTube web series that kind of features people that are big in the health and wellness atmosphere and the sporting atmosphere. And I got to talk about sexism in pro sports and mental health awareness for athletes, which was a really, really big deal for me. So 913 views, 30 shares. It was an awesome experience, and it was screened at the 2017 New York City Web Fest. So just a little snippet for you all.
You can have highlights up instantaneously. You can have anxiety or anything like that. So to have an athlete have a season-ending injury, they're not going to be able to play. They're not going to be in the right mindset, but because of the aspect of mental toughness, they don't open their mouths. In order to defeat the stigma, there needs to be more talk about mental health. I think it's super taboo to not talk about it, not open up, when there are so many people going through it.
We should talk about it. So also, my personal essays. In 2017, I made a New Year's resolution, as cliche as it sounds, to be more open and vulnerable about my struggles with mental illness, and I never put my story down on paper. So I decided to sit there and basically pull out every skeleton from my closet and share it with the world. So I shared it on my social media. My friends shared it. I got messages from people from nursery school, elementary school, middle school, high school, college. I got messages from CrossFitters from Florida, from people from Philadelphia, from someone from England. I got messages from all these people that they read my story and they could relate in the sense that, you know, the gym was their solace. They found comfort in the iron and they were able to work through their mental illness. And I also, actually, I was at a concert last week and I received an email. This girl came across one of my articles about life in grad school with anxiety and depression, and she reached out to me via my personal website and messaged me telling me that I inspired her to get help from a counselor at her school. So it goes to show that, you know, it's not just your community you impact, it's really genuinely everyone. And surveys. I did not know how to reach my community besides social media at first. So I reached out to this Instagram account called Powerlifting Women. They have over 20,000 followers and they constantly post call outs where they ask people, basically, you know, like they give advice. So I asked them, can you share this for me? And can we ask, you know, if you want to share your story, please, I want to defeat the stigma, let's talk. 1,466 likes later, 56 comments later, and 35 direct messages to my Instagram, I found a pool of people to survey and figure out what they wanted to know. I sent out a survey to 25 people. I got 25 responses. I asked them questions like, how do you think mental illness is covered in the media? You know, what do you want to know more of? When were you diagnosed? What were you diagnosed with? How do you use the gym or your sport to get through it? And then I asked them, what do you want to know? So I got athlete profiles. I got, you know, mental health resources. I want tips from you. I want to hear from pro athletes. I want to hear from this. And that's how I started to create all of my content. And it is a very, very big deal to listen. And that's a social J thing. That's definitely something that you want to do. You want to know what they want. I could throw out 1,000 articles about things that I want to know about, but if my community doesn't want it, it doesn't matter. So to conclude, I know my presentation was a little heavy, so here's a little meme for you guys. You got anxiety too or no? No? Okay. And lastly, thank you very much, but I'd like to announce that I was offered, I have accepted, and I've been working at New York Athletic Club for the last 2 months in a social media manager and assistant editor role. So that's pretty awesome. And if you guys want to collaborate or grab a beer or lift or do anything, please reach out. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Charlie Turner, and my community are Rohingya refugees. It wasn't my first choice. Initially, it was the diaspora of Burma as a whole. But after this, the violence in August, I decided to focus specifically on this refugee group. I reported in Burma a little bit last year, but it was mainly on labor rights. So this world's both foreign and familiar to me at the same time. Quickly, just some background, just so we're all on the same page. That's Burma, okay? It was a military dictatorship for over 50 years. It's changed, stayed the same. The one group that it hasn't changed for are ethnic minorities of the country. There are 135 ethnic groups that are native to Burma. That doesn't even include the Rohingya, and we'll get to that in a second. The ethnic majority group are the Bama, or Burman. That includes Aung San Suu Kyi, the military leadership. They make up about three quarters of the country. And the military has been responsible for dominating ethnic minorities. And there are many of them, and many of them live in the United States. In the past 10 years, no country has produced more refugees than Burma. That includes the Karen, a largely Christian group, the Kachin, a largely Christian group, the Chin, a largely Christian group, and of course the Rohingya, who are majority Muslim. There are roughly 7,500 living in the US now as refugees. This is one of the few that actually lives in New York City. I'm sure you guys watch the news, persecution of ethnic minorities in Burma is widespread, but to a much lesser degree compared to the Rohingya. In August, 600,000 Rohingya refugees went to Bangladesh in the span of 4 months. So since very few Rohingya refugees live in New York, I've had to communicate with them mainly over messenger services. The Chicago-Milwaukee area is a huge Rohingya hotspot. Just basically any towns that have economic problems, refugees are sent there. But I didn't limit myself to the States. Canada and Ireland were huge spots for me as well. And WhatsApp and Facebook Messenger were the only ways I've communicated with them. Facebook in Burma is the internet. It's how the searches are done. It's how entertainment's found. It's how news is gathered. From listening to my community, I learned that the needs are dire. The literacy rate in refugee camps in Bangladesh hovers around 12%. But that's basically the same here in the States. It's a little bit higher, but literacy is a huge issue. So how can I help a community that has trouble reading as a journalist? I firmly believe if anyone wants to pursue VR or AR, there's huge ways that you can help the refugee community doing that. I chose not to do that this year. I decided to focus on informational needs. And so listening to the community, I learned that context and reporting is really missing. Everyone here has probably heard of the Rohingya. Very few probably know who the Rohingya are, the history of the situation, why they're so persecuted. So using my platform at Wiki Tribune, I'm an intern and now I'm a staff reporter for Wiki Tribune. It's the news venture of Wikipedia and Jimmy Wales. I wrote an explainer explaining why the Rohingya are so persecuted. It's a new site. It's mainly just kind of like experts and friends of the organization that read it. So it's gathered roughly 500 views. But what I was really encouraged about is the talk page. And that's where readers can speak to me about things that are missing from coverage. And then I take those into account and augment my reporting. I also heard that the when was missing from these reports in international media. No one realizes that this issue has gone on for decades. So I interviewed survivors from 1978, the first ethnic cleansing campaign against the Rohingya, and created as the closest thing to I could of an oral history. Since it's wiki format, my dream is that refugees and refugee groups add to this, and we have an oral history that starts from World War II, which is roughly when Burma got independence, until now. There have been about three massive clearance operations from the Myanmar military. Oh, and this has gathered about 600 views. This is a reply when I tweeted it out. For decades, yes, from since 1978. No, they weren't displaced from Bangladesh, and they squatted in Myanmar for 1942. This is a reference to the Rohingya being illegal immigrants from Bangladesh, which is a widespread misconception or kind of slander against this ethnic group. And this brings me to the biggest need of my community, is that the people that they need the support from the most are the people from Burma, and they're not getting it. Bigotry is a huge problem for my community. Essentially, I hate to say it, if I had to guess, there's no poll, but the majority of people from Burma that aren't Rohingya probably would side with the government and not the ethnic group themselves. This is someone who's a very educated Rakhine, which is another ethnic group living in America, and she essentially thinks that the media coverage of the Rohingya is overblown and inaccurate. But there is a need for solidarity, and there is a desire for it. This is a blog post from an ethnic women's group, the Karen Women's Organization, and they essentially gave sympathy to Rohingya women because they too faced rape as a weapon, village burning, and other ethnic cleansing campaigns themselves. This Christian group in southern Burma is offering solidarity to the Rohingya. And my community were in love with this post. They thought it was the greatest thing ever. They finally felt heard from people in Burma for the first time. And that kind of gave me an idea, which is dialogue journalism. I don't know if you guys have heard of Spaceship Media. It's a group, they connected Donald Trump supporters with Hillary Clinton supporters, and they spoke over Facebook. I decided to do this, but with the ethnic groups of Burma. Of course, it's gonna have to be a little different because this issue is way more personal than the Donald Trump, Hillary Clinton election, it just is. For one, there we're talking about, sexual abuse is widespread amongst my community. People feel that they aren't a real ethnic group, so this is really a true identity question. So I wanted to avoid this. This is not a debate. I wanted this to be about people speaking about their identity while another ethnic group, while another person from another ethnic group was present, and they can share and stories about their ethnic identity and what it means to be from Burma, whether they're proud of their country, whether they think the media coverage of their country is fair. So I used Zoom conference call. It was me, one person from one ethnic group, and another from another ethnic group. And I always tried to put a Rohingya person in unless I felt like the other person would attack them. So it involved a bit of a vetting process. And some of the highlights that I found were that people are open to talking about this issue. Like I said, I had to vet people. But this person right here, who is an ethnic Karen, agreed to stop using a racial slur for Rohingya people after meeting a Rohingya person for the first time. And that's another thing. There are people that have never met a Rohingya person in their life. The majority of them haven't, but they have deeply bigoted views towards this ethnic group. So I can't tell if that's typical or surprising. And then here is an ethnic Rohingya woman, and she essentially told us and everyone and the other person in the group that she considers Bengali to be a racial slur, which is what Burmese people call Rohingya people, to kind of reference that they don't belong in the country. They're actually native to Bangladesh. So just to kind of recap what I learned is that there is a need for solidarity amongst my community. Focus on the youth when you have to, because young people are more likely to be more open-minded and multicultural compared to older folks. And then just kind of on a more macro level, traditional journalism just really doesn't break echo chambers as much as kind of putting the community at the center of the reporting process. I do believe that journalists have a role as moderators, and that means kind of extending away from debates. Debates are really better if you have experts or blowhards, right? But if you have thoughtful people who want to listen, maybe they don't know that much about the issue, they're not going to survive in a debate format. But what they can do is talk about their experience and hear how another ethnic group responds to the same questions. So I do think dialogue journalism has a future, and what I'm going to do is, once I get a good sample size of these conversations, I'm going to report out on it. And I'm not sure what that's going to look like. It's going to involve a lot of video and audio from these conversations. And then from there, I want to make sure that I'm producing something that's constructive and that helps both of my communities feel represented. I think the main thing for other people that want to try this is that just know that dialogue journalism is about putting a voice into someone else's head. And that voice might not be convincing, but it can develop an understanding. And I think the job of journalists is to make these interactions constructive and then report out from the insights that they learned. Thank you.
My name is Jessica Brockington, and 20 years ago, I started a newspaper called The Bridge Leader. It was in Washington Heights where I lived. It had one of the highest murder rates in the city, and one of my goals in publishing was to bring an even-handed voice to the neighbors, to the news that was being told about my neighbors and my neighborhood. 20 years later, one of my goals in journalism school was to learn to be digital and multimedia, to get with the times. And I chose social journalism because at its heart, it felt very much like old school community journalism. You assume that people know their own stories and that they can tell them, and you let that happen. And at the beginning, the community I chose was the interfaith community of New York. So the first thing I did, of course, was to go and follow God on social media. thank you for that laugh. So I wanted to, just to be clear, what I felt interfaith wasn't, at least for my terms. I wasn't interested in reporting on the most extreme elements of the faith community in New York City. So I wasn't interested in the most isolated or the extreme or the fundamentalist groups. What I found and decided interfaith would be the collaborative, the progressive, the civically engaged organizations. And of course, Trump gave us quite a bit to work with this year. New York City of Love was how I framed my reporting. I spent a lot of time in the streets. I tweeted, I made explainers and social videos. I wrote stories for Medium, and I had two goals. One of them was professional. It was to learn to use all of these new technologies. And the other was to amplify voices that are not getting heard in the noise of extreme reporting. I'm about to fall off of here, so I won't. And I found along the way that a lot of faith leaders are still really stuck in old-fashioned ways of communicating, and they weren't taking on the new media. So I I just wanted to point out that when I talk about extreme voices, the a Quaker group, it's a peace activist group, the American Friends Service Committee, has written that in 3 months, in 2015, they looked at 1,600 news articles and found that the major networks provided no coverage of nonviolent responses to extremism. So let's see. So I went to a lot of events. I tweeted, I filmed and tweeted. I, you know, the UN Forum on Faith, did a lot of slideshows. I went to interfaith seders and church basements and reported the stories and tried to amplify what was going on in this community to get a sense of, you know, what was happening in the sanctuary movement and in Dhaka and in North Korea and how were people of faith and civic-mindedness talking about these issues. One interfaith group had a candidates forum. They did actually 12 of those across the city. This was Dhaka. These will be people that you know if you've been reporting on these communities. I had a chance to interview Ruth Messenger last week. That was kind of a highlight for me personally. Invited into a mosque during an Oxfam event. These were people I interviewed about North Korea. So there's a lot of, you know, there was a lot of just down in the streets reporting. And I wanted to highlight these folks in particular. It's really kind of hippie. Like the interfaith community is really kind of, the last time Americans were engaged like this was the 1960s, and there's this paradigm that people are still using. It's a toolkit that people are still using. Whoa, let's not do that again. But I also wanted to point out that they needed to get kind of, they needed to kind of get with it. And I wanted to introduce you to another friend of mine here. This is Jeff Trenchard, who's this badass immigration attorney.
Racism isn't a speed bump.
Do you have any volume here?
Otherwise smooth American highway, right? Like it's the asphalt. It's the nature of our system.
You don't have to go too far. So when he had a major win down at ICE and he got a client out, he put on social media that, you know, he wasn't walking around singing "This Little Light of Mine." He was doing rap hands, which I thought was kind of fun. I attended a digital ministry boot camp, and that kind of set me for my practicum in a way, because I started hearing about the concerns that faith leaders had about being in social media. And it was the exact intersection between my personal development as a journalist, as a digital journalist, and the reporting I was actually doing on my community. I retweeted Paul Rauschenbusch, who is a thought leader in this kind of thing. And I think the quotes that I selected were really kind of moving. Brick and mortar religious traditions were the slowest to realize that the truth is up for grabs. We hear that it echoed in the fake news discussion. He questioned, what is community going to mean? You know, when two or three are gathered online, is Jesus there? You know, is there a minion? Think about augmented reality and Bible stories. What would Jesus look like on the cross? These are real. And then justice. You know, internet can be leveraged to promote justice, but it is itself a justice issue. It's access, regarding access, and it's rigged. So I put out a survey to my community and asked just about how they were using digital ministry in their congregations. And I just found that these were a bunch of Luddites. People were really not using this stuff. Most of them were really hard to find, too. Like, just getting in touch to say, hey, I did a social video with you guys not too long ago. I wanted to share it with you, and finding, like, the email didn't work. It was just the best way to find, you know, Reverend Hauser, who I showed you a picture of before, was really to walk down 71st Street and say, hey, what are you doing today? Otherwise, it was almost impossible to get him. I got an opportunity to follow one of the digital ministry thought leaders, Jim Keats. His title at Riverside Church is Associate Minister of Digital Strategy and Online Engagement. So he's really at the forefront right now. So what I just realized was that I was sitting in the middle of a newsroom of very thoughtful communicators right here, and I wondered what they would say to my community. How does that, you know, what advice would they have? They certainly, many of them come from faith traditions. So I took a page out of Jeremy's page book with the Munchkins and Carrie's with the sign saying, hey, what would you say to faith leaders? And sat in the newsroom. I figured if I could get through 50 Munchkins, I'd probably have some good interviews. I taped them all one afternoon, and I asked people, what advice do you have for faith leaders getting into social media? Oh, and have a donut. And I asked staff. I lined them all up, and I tweeted them out in two mornings. And they were wonderful. Here's some of the stuff that people said. Every single person had something different to say. And it was really gratifying because not only did I feel like I was elevating my community here and voices that I care very much about, but they were also really speaking to some of the issues that that faith leaders would enjoy hearing about. So I've put in front some of the, they got over 500 views on Twitter, which was really nice. Through some of the, I won't go through all of them, there's no time. And this was some of the feedback that I got, whether it was comments or retweeting or people connecting me into their own hashtags and the conversations that are happening there. And I also realized, this is my last slide, but I did want to say that I realized that, you know, here I've been sitting doing a Twitter storm for a group that isn't on Twitter, which makes no sense at all. And I thought, so how do I bridge that? Because I do think it's a really important conversation. And I realize that the next step is to go to Facebook, where there are slightly more faith leaders connecting with their congregations there. And then also to, I think, a meetup, like something really good and old-fashioned. And I think social journalism gives us the latitude to do stuff like that and encourage us to have real connections with people. So I thank you.
Check, check.
Mic, check. Okay, it's working. So, nope, this is the one from Angelo Paura. Why I'm so nervous if I love to talk with people normally? Well, it's been a rough year. My name is Laura Calzada. I come from Barcelona, and tonight I'm going to talk to you about socially engaged art. Back in January, when I was thinking which community to focus on, I knew that art was going to be there. And then Simon Dove introduced me to socially engaged art, and that fascinates me because it is a form of art that connects art and social change. The artist gets out of the studio practice, the isolation of the studio practice, and co-creates with the community, empowers the community. As Simon Dove put it, it's a moving away from the artist who is the great master, who can illuminate the world with his genius, to the artist who is someone who catalyzes community action. Here we have Immigrant Movement International in Corona, Queens, New York. It is a community center that started out as an art project by artist, Cuban artist Tania Bruguera. Bruguera is known by her concept of arte útil, useful art, which merges, combines practical and creative skills. What happened in this community center? In this community center, they do social, they provide social services and with also art and activism. I went up to Corona, to Queens, just to check it out and see about their activities, and I engage in a couple of classes of dance classes. I don't know if they are Colombians. There is a Colombian over there. It was Bullerengue and Mapale, two dances. It was a very enriching afternoon, and I could see how they serve the community up there in Queens. How I continued listening and learning about the social engaged art world. I spoke with 26 stakeholders, and I attended 13 events. And that was really inspiring because all the people in this community are, very knowledgeable on this topic. What I discovered is that the social engaged art community needs funding that comes from grants, fellowships, and so forth. And they also lack recognition because a lot of people are still skeptical of the power of art to really enact change. And then I saw there is ego. At the end of the day, they are artists and there are some egos. So a lot of projects that I saw, some similar projects that they could join forces and really, you know, work together. They need that a little bit more of collaboration to really impact. What else? What I did? Then I wrote stories. I wrote stories to inform and to connect socially engaged artists with institutions like the Queens Museum, which is a museum that is leading the way, spearheading the change on what a public museum, what is the role of a public museum in our society. Then I also was, I published in Hyperallergic. That was a great experience. Hyperallergic is an awesome publication on the arts with a very loyal audience. What is the success of Hyperallergic? It started like a little blog, and now they are very respected. Hyperallergic serves a community. They have a passion, and they have an expertise. And that's basically this big success of Hyperallergic. They are focused very well, and they do very well what they do. We go to engagement. One of the stories had over 1,400 likes on Instagram. Another one had 1,200 views. But then again, we are social journalists, and we've been talking a lot about engagement. And this, the metric that really, that I feel really, really important, is the qualitative one: quality over quantity. And here you can see a couple of comments of two artists, Renee and Ronnie, that I've been following their work throughout the year. And you know, when you see these comments or hear a comment of a teacher, a professor, thank you for your bravery. I've been able to share your story with so many of my undocumented students. This is a story on Maria de Los Angeles. She's an artist and a DACA recipient. This really make me feel, you know, your work has an influence. It's helping people, and with the artists, helping them, taking pictures in their events. And Ronnie really liked that little video I did. So yeah, the qualitative impact, it's important. And now we arrive at the local, Crown Heights. This center, I wanna talk to you about this center in Crown Heights, Brooklyn, my neighborhood. There is this storefront space that is rented out by a church. You're gonna say, what is this, the relationship? You're gonna discover it soon. The relationship is that this church wanted to engage with a broader community of Crown Heights. And here is when I stepped in, because you know, it's near my place, 2 minutes walking. So what is this? Cultivate, Brooklyn Arts, Education, Culture, says yes, and we wanna engage with the community. We want them to know that we are here. So, I helped tailor a survey focusing on the assets of the community, on what they could offer, what were their needs, and how their assets could help their neighbors. Then I led this survey effort, and we ended up talking with 108 neighbors. We used three strategies, and you know, very basic, very simple. It's a listening post. I sit down in front of the center, and I went through the survey in a conversational way with the neighbors, and they could tell me their needs, and it was really beautiful way to engage with the community in Crown Heights. We also set up an event with a community group, SOS, Save Our Streets, the Youngs in Bed-Stuy and Crown Heights, and they did the survey. I find out that going one-on-one and to talk to them, it was also the way to really get the information, because in a big group, the guys were more quiet. And we also visit seniors at a senior center. So we went and we talked with all the neighbors in this way. What are the most important lessons I learned? Well, cooperate with the different institutions in the neighborhood is key, like the cooperation, and also that people value honesty and transparency. They are gonna be really eager to collaborate with you and with your reporting if they understand the value of what you're doing. little video, you see some of the neighbors of Crown Heights.
Amazing. Dynamic and vibrant. It's pretty safe.
Yeah. Mountain pop for all races.
Fun, enjoying, and loving. Full of life.
You may take the beautiful place.
I will feel it.
Lively.
It's a growing community.
Tolerant and diverse.
We've got Pacific, Caribbean, Americans.
Good people. Good neighborhood.
Crown Heights is becoming one nation.
So, yeah, I collect all these surveys. Then I engage with a very useful tool for journalists, Excel. We sometimes don't like it, but we need it. And we need it very much. And what I discovered is that, yes, the community wanted a space, a free space, where basically these are the three main things that they would like to do in that space. After school programming, focus on mentoring, engage in arts and cultural activity, they said singing, drawing. The elders talk about writing their stories. The kids talk a lot about music. And then a space of community building. Talk about the problems that arise home and also issues of in the community. So these were the three main uses that they would give to that space. What is the next step? Well, the next step is to share all this knowledge, all this information with the neighborhood institutions, including the Brooklyn Museum, because as a public museum, maybe we can reproduce something similar what the Queens Museum did with that first example that I showed you at the beginning, Immigrant Movement International, and eventually Cultivate Brooklyn will become its own non-profit organization. What happened? What happened with this project? What did I learn? Well, some of the basics of social journalism. Before starting anything, I know that everybody here is pretty much knows about social journalism. So, but yeah, before starting any venture, just listen to the community. Just listen. Don't start. If these people in the church, when we are gonna set up a yoga, I arrived to 9 minutes. I didn't thought about that. A yoga, how do you know if they want a yoga class? You have to ask your community. Then cooperate with the different institutions on your neighborhood and the key leaders. That's heavy, eh? And then know their basic language so you understand where they are coming from, and then collaborate, let your audience collaborate with your reporting. By including them and by respecting them, you'll gain their trust. But really including them, it's just not about the quote or about that story. It's about creating, sustaining, developing a relationship. Finally, the only thing I hope to have instilled in all of you tonight is the importance of conversation, and that art is alive, and it's a wonderful tool to empower our communities and to foster individual thinking. Thank you.
Let the grass grow, but don't let her go.
Okay, hi everybody. My name is Angelo Paura. I'm a correspondent here in New York for an Italian newspaper called Il Sole 24 Ore, and I'm here to talk to you about virtual reality and the future of journalism. But let me start with a story This guy here is not a spiritual leader, but is Tiziano Terzani, one of the most prominent war reporter of the last century. And I met him 10 years ago when I was a young reporter, and I talked to him and I tried to ask him, how can I become a journalist? And he told me, you can never say I'm a journalist, but you have to be in the right place at the right moment. You see the horizon, but you can never reach it. So you have to be in movement, and this is journalism. So after 10 years, I decided to apply and to follow his suggestion and to start exploring what's next in journalism. But I felt stuck in a desert, too many stories and too many issues. So I ended up narrow down my topics, and I decide to work with the immersive journalism community. Why VR? Because I think it is the next big thing in journalism after the PC revolution and after the internet and after mobile, we have virtual reality. I give you some data. By 2025, we are going to have a market value of 80 billions, and the user will be half a billion, so a pretty big share. So I start listening to my community, and I understand that is a really diverse community, is a super spread out, and with different point of view, and full of conflicts. The stakeholders, that is creatives, developers, entrepreneurs, journalists and producer, and media theorists. During the listening and using the social journalism tools, I understood, which is the main issues inside the community. We have a big ethical question, and in this moment of fake news and populism, it's really important to make clear what is journalism and what is entertainment. We have also lack of investment and cost, and at the same time, we have a problem of penetration in the newsroom and within the consumers' communities. How I engage my community? So I start with surveys, with Google Groups, with direct contact, and with VR events, going to VR events. My outreach, I reach roughly 100 stakeholders. I did 4 surveys, 10 interviews, and I participated to 12 events. Some outcomes, I get more credibility and trust inside the community. I find the real needs of my community, and I develop services and story for the people. So here are some of my works. The first one is Hacking Journalism, that is basically a video interview platform to describe the conflict and to create a space to share. This is the landing page, and here you have some of the people that I interview. This is Douglas Rushkoff, media theorist, that is pretty sure that VR is just for advertising and not for journalism. I interview Jimmy Pallott, one of the pioneer of immersive journalism, and then I interview Ethan Zuckerman, the director of the Center of Civic Media at MIT, and Jeff Jarvis here at CUNY. Then I produce a podcast called Atacama, exploring how technology is changing our perception, politics, and the society in which we live. This is the landing page, and here is me working on the podcast. I want to show you a really quick promo of the podcast. So let me come back to the presentation. So during this year, I also wrote articles for my newspaper, Sole 24 Ore. I did audio reportage for Radio 24, that is an Italian radio station. And also I wrote some Medium posts. Here there is some of my products. And I'm actually work on a VR story, a feature story about virtual reality and the problem of ethics in journalism. Here are some of my metrics on Medium. And finally, the event. So I organized here at CUNY an event with Jimmy Palot, that is like the founder of Emblematic, one of the most important outlet for immersive journalism. And here you have some photo of the event. So what's next? I'm in the process to sell my podcast in Italy, that is 5 episodes. And the first series. And then next year I'm going to work in Italy with some Italian journalism school in Milan, Turin, and Rome to do literacy and to describe my research to the students. My research that is like a work in progress, but because as Jerome Lanier told us, VR is a preview of what might be like when technology gets better someday. Thank you.
Okay, so that was embarrassing. So hi, my name is Alexandria Sanford. I am actually making my return to journalism. So my undergrad degree is from Ohio University, from E.W. Scripps School of Journalism in Athens, Ohio. But I also got my first master's at CUNY's John Jay School of Criminal Justice. So that brought me to my community that I covered this year, women in mass incarceration, but I did not start there. I started wanting to cover formerly incarcerated people and entrepreneurship, but through my social journalism practice, I found that women who are in mass incarceration are kind of left out of the conversation. So just to tell you a little bit about my community, women are the fastest growing population of incarcerated people in the United States. They grow at a 50% higher rate than men since the 1980s. And incarcerated women face unique challenges. 82% of incarcerated women are in prison or jail for nonviolent offenses. 67% are victims of sexual assault by correction staff. And only 1/3 receive prenatal care of pregnant incarcerated women. They also have higher rates of mental trauma and addiction prior to incarceration, and there are fewer resources and educational programs in prison and upon release. So I'm not a part of that community, so I had to break in, and I had to listen, and I had to make myself available. So I listened several ways. I first started on social media via Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. I actually did meet sources there, but I also was there in person. I interned at John Jay's Prisoner Reentry Institute, where I was a communications intern, and I went to several events. I live tweeted for them. I handled their Twitter account. I went to the Smart on Crime conference in October and was there just to be present and to listen to needs of the community. And I also am currently holding focus groups at Exodus Transitional Community about a project that I'll tell you about a little bit later. So these are just examples of the way that I interacted with my community on social media. I just felt that it would be great there to engage and to be visible on social to see that I was part of the community. As you can see, I interacted with a panelist from the Smart on Crime conference. And this night at the Riker screening, I actually met one of my first sources and most reliable sources on Twitter. I also attended the Rethinking Reentry Conference in September. And this was about the best practices for reentry and making it better for everyone. But as you can see, women were on the panel, and some were formerly incarcerated women there as well. So the work that I produced. I created a Medium publication and with 10 pieces of original reporting, meaning that I sought out sources and interviewed them for my pieces. I created a Facebook community online called On Your Own Reentry that has 53 likes and follows. And I created three multimedia projects, an audio project, audio report, social video, and an infographic. Some of the stories that are featured on my Medium publication, I did a data story about the shelter dangers of broken windows policing and how that affects rearrest rates in New York City. I did a story featuring a woman from Cincinnati, Ohio, about the unique challenges women face while incarcerated. And I did an audio report with two formerly incarcerated people about the importance of them being part of the conversation on the policy, like in government and policy formation. So here are my top three pieces on Medium. I just wanted to highlight that I actually have a 54% read ratio, which I think is really good. And the great thing about these pieces are that the sources in them, they were the ones who actually shared these, and I can actually thank them for that reach. this is my Facebook page, and again, once I, you know, like tag people in my posts or encourage them to share, that's how I got my the most reach and engagement online. Again, lots of shares and lots of tags. This was my most read piece, The Formerly Incarcerated Woman Builds Hope in the Bronx. And this is a video of her. Topeka Sam is a formerly incarcerated woman. She actually came out and wanted to provide housing for other formerly incarcerated women who didn't have the same support that she did. And I'll let you watch the video.
A lot of people were being released with less support than I did. I had my family, both my parents, my brothers, my friends, and I knew that my transition would be fairly easy.
Was invited to the actual open house of Hope House, which was great. I got to meet some other formerly incarcerated women who are part of that community, her supporters, and actually the woman here talking, Susan Burton, is her mentor. She created reentry programs and creates housing for formerly incarcerated women in LA. So what I learned through this was basically that formerly incarcerated women, their main concern upon release is housing. And it's very hard for them to find, especially here in New York City. I mean, we all know how hard housing is to find for anyone, but especially if you have felonies or if you have issues with, you know, getting your children back. So Kathy Morris is one woman, she's formerly incarcerated, and she works at the PD Green program. And she explained to me that, you know, when she came out, there was only one place that she felt like women could go, and that was our children in Long Island City. Diana McHugh of the Women's Prisoner Association, she talked to me about the issues with women coming out with children and how it's, you know, how it's hard for them to find housing if they don't have their children, but then they need to have their children to be able to find housing. So it's kind of a double-edged sword. And again, Topeka Sam, there's housing for women with children, but not much for women without, and that's why she focuses on single women. So moving forward, I can't provide housing. So I tried to come up with a way to make it easier for women, formerly incarcerated women, to find housing and other resources, but ultimately it will help all formerly incarcerated people. I am working on a website or a online catalog called On Your Own Reentry. This is what I'm doing with Exodus as far as holding focus groups and getting their feedback. Basically, you'll be able to create a customized list of resources throughout the city and where you can find them. Because there are plenty of resources for formerly incarcerated people across the city, a lot of nonprofits, but there's no one place to find them. And again, this is for anybody. This could be for social workers, this could be for parole officers, this could be for loved ones, children, girlfriends, husbands. Anybody should go on the site and be able to find customized lists for people. I will be working with The Last Mile, and they employ currently incarcerated people in San Quentin to be developers and engineers in building websites. And so I just felt like it would be full circle to include them on this project. They're really excited about it. I'm really excited about it. But we need money. So that's my next step. And so my insights from my year as a social journalist is to build trust. Again, I'm not part of this community. And the main thing that people asked me was, why did I care? And I had to tell them. I mean, I told them that I'm a master of criminal justice, and that, you know, like, while I'm not part of this community, I feel like I am, or that I could be affected by it, and that I just care. And so the important part was to work with the people and organizations already doing the work, because they know what they're doing, and just support them. And to be physically present at these events, I saw a lot of familiar faces, and that helped me gain trust because they weren't surprised and knew what I was there for. I engaged on social. Everyone is online, not everyone, but most people are online, and have your community share your work, especially if they're part of it. People like to hear their own stories, and they like to share that. And so that's it. And if you have any questions or you have money for funding, let me know.
Hi everyone, my name is Christine Villanueva. I am currently an intern at Storyful, which is a social media verification newswire. And I covered the underground music community here in the greater New York City area. This is a community that is very close to my heart. But before I get into exactly what I learned and what I did for my practicum, I first want to talk a little bit about who exactly is in my community. So the people in my community are typically artists and musicians who live and perform in converted warehouses and factories that have been turned into music venues and galleries.
the people in my community are also traditionally marginalized groups like the LGBTQA community, as well as undocumented immigrants, women, and people of color. What kind of separates them from other independent artists are the fact that they're very politically engaged, they're social justice oriented, and they have a willingness to start grassroots movements. So that is very different from YouTubers and buskers. I think one person who really describes what it's like to be at a DIY or an underground music space is it's similar to the difference of going to your friend's house for dinner versus going to dinner with them at a restaurant. So I think that analogy is a really great way to describe the inclusivity that this community strives for. So how exactly did I listen to this community? Well, first and foremost, I want to say that I made sure that I was present in this community. I went to community meetings, I went to shows, and I just made sure that I was a presence there. I asked people, what are some of the things that you don't see covered that you would want to see covered? And I made sure to have human connections with them, first and foremost, before being a journalist, which helped really impact my my work. And I also was able to figure out where people were meeting in real life and online, which brings me to my next point, which is that follow-ups matter. So whenever I wrote a piece or I produced a video about something that someone had told me about or inspired by a conversation I had, I made it a point to shoot them a message. I made it a point to say, hey, here's a resource. I think this could help you or somebody that you know. And in that way, I was able to build relationships and build trust. And when I say that follow-ups matter, they really matter. People started sharing my stories. People started getting really excited about the work that I was doing. And that in part has to do with the fact that I relinquished some control and I invited people along for the ride. So what I did was I really let my community lead me. If we're going to recast journalism as a service, we need to allow for community feedback so that we will know some of the things that people want to know and report on the things that they want to know about. But not only that, we have to use the appropriate channels to ensure that our audience is actually getting the information that they need. Instead of throwing out links on the social media ether, we really need to strategize and make sure that the people that need to know the things we're reporting on know them. One example that I did earlier in this year was I had a conversation with a recovering heroin addict who found her support system through the underground music scene, despite the fact that drugs were present. I also was able to dispel some of the stereotypes behind the sex, drugs, and rock and roll saying. And another piece that I did was about women in the punk scene. I think a lot of women were telling me that they wanted more of an outlet. They wanted to address some of the issues with sexism in a male-dominated music scene. So I was able to kind of elevate their voices and their importance in diversifying the space. And as great as community-led stories are, your community can't tell you everything. And they're going to look to you for your journalistic expertise and news judgment to fill in some gaps in reporting that they wouldn't normally see. So a lot of this has to do with extraneous listening and finding those gaps and reporting on them. One example that I often cite is about the legislation regarding the nightlife mayor, who is going to be the liaison between the nightlife industry and New York City Hall. So by covering some of these topics regarding policy, people were able to be more informed and become better knowledgeable activists. I also covered underground musicians as experiencing hate in America, and I was able to take kind of those larger political stories and find out that they were relevant in this space also. And while at first I thought this story was going to be about bands who are touring in more conservative parts of the country that were hailing from, you know, also liberal New York, I actually found out after I dropped the piece into a Facebook group that people didn't really need to leave their home states or their little bubbles to face this type of discrimination. And by allowing for that feedback, I was able to add that extra layer to my reporting. So for my practicum, I did three different things. The first was a Medium publication called Edge of Sound, which I showed you some examples of previously. But I also did an Instagram page and a zine. A zine is essentially a handmade magazine. And I distributed 100 of them at a show in Brooklyn at a DIY space. But there was a twist. Instead of printing whole articles, what I did instead was I printed partial articles and then prompted people to text in a keyword so that they could get the full link to the link to the full piece. And by doing that, I didn't want to rely on traditional print metrics to kind of measure that impact. I wanted to know what exactly in my zine people were reading and engaging with, and in that way I could inform my editorial process moving forward. So out of 100 people, guess how many text-ins I got? Zero. But that's okay. A lot of people said that this wasn't a bad idea. It just might have been kind of poorly executed. But this all circles back to a point that I had made earlier, that being there actually matters. I was able to see people interacting with my product. People were giving me really amazing and positive feedback. But I think that once band started playing, people got a little distracted and forgot to text in, even if they wanted to. So a huge thing that I learned by doing this type of work is that an extra step could be a huge leap for people. Because you catch them at the wrong time. But not all hope is lost. For Instagram, I use this as a supplement for the types of things I was writing in my zine and on Medium. And I had to envision what an Instagram article would look like. And at first, I thought it would be a synthesized version of the inverted pyramid or a basic news article, but that wasn't getting a lot of engagement. And by engagement, I mean likes. And I used likes as a metric for positive community feedback. I wasn't trying to get likes for like's sake, but I tried to find meaning behind them. And so I took that as a cue to kind of change the editorial strategy. And I made my captions a paragraph or two at most, ended with a strong quote or kicker. And that ended up getting 4 times more engagement than before I had made these adjustments. And on Medium, I had a 41% average engagement rate, which meant that 41% of my audience actually read through whole articles, which was pretty rewarding considering that most people will read only halfway through and 6 out of 10 Americans will only read headlines. So what now? What I would do is I would get community feedback, I would make adjustments, I would reiterate my project and try again. I think a huge part of doing community engagement work in journalism is understanding that you might not get it right the first time, and that's okay. So the only thing that you really need to do is move on from failure very quickly, and the only time you ever really fail is if you quit. Thank you so much. My name is Christine Villanueva. I have physical copies of my zine with me, but you can check it out at bit.ly/edgeofsound. I'm on social at Christine_ish, and my email is right on the screen. Thank you so much.
As you can see, these guys did a great job. So much work went into that. You can see all of the passion and enthusiasm. Thank all of you. I know after a long day at work, everyone's tired, but now we get to go eat and drink. So please join us. All right. Thanks to everyone.